located on your smartphone or tablet. Download now by searching Bakersfield Californian in the Apple, Google, and Amazon app stores.
Welcome back to Be Varsity Live. Zach Ewing here, along with Trevor Horn and Chris Barnes, Lawrence White, and Brian Nixon, Liberty head coach, has joined us. And Coach, I brought you on. I, from a coach's perspective, you've been through this recruiting thing a lot. Obviously, Cody was high profile and some less profile, high profile guys. It's a learning process for you too, isn't it? I mean, just from the high school coach's perspective about what college coaches mean, when to call them, when to have them call you, that sort of thing.
Definitely. There's a lot of rules that fall into place there with when they can be out of the office, when they can't, how these guys can talk to kids, how the kids can call them, but they can't call the kid back. So we have to find a time when they're going to be in the office so the kids can actually talk to them. But it's definitely a learning curve, and it's hard to get these guys up to speed on some of this stuff and relay some of that. But I've had to learn the hard way myself going through this for so many years. But it's still, at the end of the day, it's a great process that these kids get the opportunity to go through.
Sure. When you have a guy like Chris or like mm-hmm. Cody or Anthony, who you know is going to get some offers and some attention, is there a meeting you have with them where you sit down and say, hey, this is my advice for you, or is that done as the process goes along? What's your policy?
We talk about it early, because recruiting starts so early now, right, that you have to have that conversation. And hey, where do you want to go? Give me 20 schools. We'll start sending film out to each and everyone. And you kind of have that process that you go through, and you talk with the parents a little bit and say, hey, these are the things that are going to take place. And you just kind of preface them a little bit on the whole situation.
Brian, we're talking about these big-time recruits like these mm-hmm. two are. I want to talk about Alex Gallen yesterday, yeah, and that whole situation where you talked about when he finally got that offer from Yale, he walked into your office, and he was like a kid on Christmas. You talk about that situation, what you alluded to, and then even being able to now send off four guys from the West Coast all the way to the East Coast and like Yale.
Yeah, no, Alex, he really worked hard to fine-tune his craft, and being a punter-kicker type guy, they have to spend a lot of time in. And a lot of guys won't give those guys scholarships. You know, and some they're asking him. He got preferred walk-on opportunities, and he wanted to find a home, and he did his homework, and we sent stuff out, and finally they got a home. And he was kind of on the bubble because they were looking at a couple punters. And Yale, a situation in the Ivy League, they have these bands. You know, band one, band two, band three, band four, and that goes on their grades and the situation where they can get guys into school. And they needed a band four punter. And it was kind of a perfect fit for Alex, and it fit, and I couldn't have been happier to watch him come in and say, hey, they said yes, and give me a hug. And that was just a great situation and a great time to be a part of.
I mean, and you're almost like Zach said with Dennis Manning yesterday, you're a surrogate father to these guys, and here you are with four of your surrogate sons and sending them all off. Ruben Guerrera, who didn't get his first offer until 2 weeks ago, his first and only offer from UTEP, and he's like, yeah, I want to go. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, obviously Anthony's been waiting, you know, verbaled with Arizona for a long time. Braylon had a fantastic season. Alex in there. I mean, mm-hmm. how much fun is it for you to sit there and go, wow, I got four guys going off? You don't get that opportunity very often.
No, you don't. And it's a proud moment for our program, for our school, for these kids and their families. And it's like I tell my wife and kids, hey, now we get to go all over the country and watch kids play. Right. And that's kind of our goal, is we want to go watch all these guys play. So mark on the bucket list, Harvard-Yale game. So yeah, got to try to make that one. That'll be awesome.
Well, that was like you in August when right after you guys beat Mission Viejo, I called you that next day. Mm-hmm. And lo and behold, we're in the same place because right, we're both going to watch Cody play football at USC. And that's the best part of it. If, you know, Chris here, if he decides to play somewhere locally, you know, you're going to be doing the same thing where you may be playing a team in Southern California and you wake up the next day and you're watching him playing somewhere down here, right?
Love yeah. it. Doesn't get much better. Get to take our kids and watch them too. So it's a part.
Brian, when do you – I mean, you don't necessarily want to waste a college coach's time. You're not mm-hmm. going to send him film on every player you've got.
Right.
At what point would you go through the process? I mean, is it just a feel? I know that's a Division I kid or a Division II or a four-year college kid. When do you kind of pull the trigger on that decision?
We have a conversation with the kid and the family as well. You know, we have that and we say, okay, what are your goals? These are your pipe dreams. I want to be an SEC guy or – And then we kind of have to be honest with them at some point and say, okay, if this doesn't happen and they don't say yes to your film, we need to have another avenue of success. Would you be willing to go to a Division II or a place like that. Because the way I look at it, there's always a place to play. There's a home for everybody if they really want to go and play football and get a degree.
Has it become a bigger part of your job in the time you've been coaching?
Recruiting? I think so, yes. You know, because some guys take it, yes, it's part of the job. Some guys don't, but that's our job to get guys to the next level. And I think it helps our program. It helps our kids. And like I've always said, if they can go and get a college degree and play the game of football, then, man, there's nothing better.
Tell those of us who aren't football experts. I mean, I know Lawrence was a thorn in your side when you played him. And then, Chris, you've obviously coached. What do you see in these guys that colleges would be interested in?
Oh, I think first is character. And just getting to talk to Lawrence outside a little bit, you know, character and knowing that they can play the game of football, be well-rounded, humble athletes, I think that's just a diamond for these guys to say, hey, they're good kids, they're low maintenance. We know they're going to go to the weight room on time. We know they're going to make their meetings on time. We aren't going to have to wonder where they are, call them and get them out of bed. They're going to be where they need to be when they're supposed to be there. So I think that's seeing these guys look at, hey, I want a low-maintenance guy that can do everything we ask him to do.
They're like the anti-Johnny Football.
Amen.
See, he's a smart guy. You should listen to him.
I do.
Trevor, we have a few minutes left. Let's throw up the girls' basketball rankings real quick, Chris, and get through that because we do want to do that.
Not a lot of changes. Liberty jumps in there at number 20 based off how they've looked against some of the top-tier teams at SWIL, but also how some of the other bottom tiers just weren't doing it. We didn't have much change. Tehachapi still in there at 19. They're the number three team in the SYL right now behind the two teams you'll see in Independence and Ridgeview. Mishinoka still in there, Menachi, Fresno. It really is kind of a down year in the area. You see a lot of – these are all out-of-area teams. There is absolutely no change here between 15 and 11.
A lot of non-Division I teams, too.
A lot of non-Division I. That's one thing that I think you see in girls' basketball. It doesn't matter what division you're in. If you can get two or three good players, you play well. The Independence-Ridgeview, that's obviously going to change after Independence handedly beat the Wolfpack last night. Orosi actually dropped a few spots, not because they're not winning. It's because I've seen some other teams like Hanford, like Clovis North, that I think are playing better against better competition. Chris, let's go to the top five. Clovis is in there, Fresno Edison, and then Centennial. You know, that's a great team, and they're going to give Garces fits next week once again when that second game in the SWIL is played at Garces. And Clovis West, I mean, Andy Bogart and I know the Pagmeter have Clovis West.
Pagmeter moved Garces to
Garces
one
number
well.
One. It's a coin toss right now, but I think Garces has the edge because that X factor in CJ West.
Now, we didn't have B-Varsity Live last week. I was in San Luis Obispo covering wrestling. But 2 weeks ago, was it 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, we were talking to Pagmeter and you made your bold prediction there. I have to remind people of this because this is on the record now. And you guys are witnesses now. Trevor, a few weeks ago, we were talking about girls' basketball.
Hair.
And he said, Chris, does he have beautiful hair?
Don't say it.
Absolutely.
He's got oily hair.
Ooh, oily hair. It's a Bakersfield thing. okay. If Garces and Clovis, this is what Trevor said. If Garces and Clovis West do not meet for the Valley Final in Division I, Trevor's going to shave his head.
Mm. Wow.
And I told that to Clayton Madden, the Centennial basketball coach, the next night, and he said, tell him to get his clippers ready. So if Centennial or, you know, an Edison or Clovis North
or
somebody
whoever
should get in there and beat one of those two teams, we're going to do that right on the show, I think.
Are you going to have the winning coach come in and shave my head?
Yeah, I think so. Clayton Madden shaved his head, so he knows what he's doing.
I'm afraid that he's going to have a pistol on his head.
No.
Scare the living bejesus out of
him. He's a serious guy, but he's a nice guy. But you know, I'm sure he'll gladly do the honors there.
Well, maybe he'll come from work and still have, because he is a deputy. So
you're gonna look like a Walter White if we shave your head.
Heisenberg.
You guys watch Breaking Bad. He's gonna look like Walter White if we shave. So I'm really looking forward to it. I have to say, I don't root for anybody, but I'm kind of rooting for that. So
what's the saying in one of the last episodes? Tread lightly. So
okay, may have guys. Well, we have a couple of minutes. I like to do this. Give me something off the field, off the court, you like to do with your time, Chris.
Not too much. I kind of just like to sit back, hang out with friends, and kind of bum it around pretty much.
You like to travel? You're going to do a lot of traveling this year.
Yeah, I know. Me and my dad are actually going to start traveling a little bit and get up to colleges and stuff like that. I traveled to Boise State on April 4th for the junior day. And
okay.
So the more days will come when I start
it will not
coaches.
Be 9 degrees that day, Chris.
I hope not, because that was freezing.
Lawrence, off the field, what makes you tick?
I like to ride dirt bikes.
Okay.
Really?
Really?
All
right. Yeah. You know, when you sign a pro contract, they're probably going to nix that. Get it in now. Yeah. Where do you ride?
Just out in the fields, anywhere. Wherever. Yeah.
Have you done that your whole life, basically, or?
About a couple of years ago.
Did it start with scooters and then you move up? And
yeah, bikes, and then, you know, my dad, he bought me my first dirt bike, and that's when it all started. All
right.
So it's a family thing. Do you take any of the guys out, any of your friends out there with you?
Yeah. Chase Mears, he likes to go, so.
Okay.
He knows a little thing about racing from his family, too.
You think?
Just a little bit. All right, guys, we appreciate it. Josh Webb from Scout.com from Barkboard was here. You can follow him on Twitter, Fight on Twist. Trev Horn.
At Trev Horn. Yeah.
Brian Nixon's not on Twitter, I don't think, are you? Are we ever going to get him on Twitter?
So we got L_Wheezy25. Yeah. Is that right? Yeah. That's Mr. Lawrence White.
And then you're just Chris Barnes, right?
Yep.
But that's K-R-Y-S, Chris.
Yeah, yep. Different.
So where'd that come from, by the way?
I'm not too sure. My parents, my whole family are all Ks. I guess decided to make me a K. And
I like it. It's unique.
You got a Brian with a Y over here and a Chris with a Y.
Yeah, that's right. And I'm Zach Ewing. You can follow me at Z Ewing and follow us at BVarsity Live. We'll see you next week on Thursday,
Facebook,
2 o'clock,
Twitter,
right here on Bakersfield.com. Have a good one, everybody.
Bye-bye.